life and healing. We gather today to hear the words of your love as you touch our hearts with holy balm. Open our hearts and spirits, and let your merciful spirit dwell within us, that, having heard the good news, we may bring that hope to others. Amen. Please stand as we sing the opening hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, hymn number 384. To worship. How shall we live when shadows gather? What was hidden has been revealed. We are woven together with all creation. Let us worship God, who is our light and salvation. Our opening prayer. God of abundance, we are thankful for the beauty all around us. Keep us together in a life full of goodness and joy. Help us to move in harmony with one another and with all creation. Let us travel on your path. Amen. And the prayer of confession. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, only Son of God, eternally begotten, Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnated of the Holy Spirit and of the Virgin Mary, became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, suffered death and was buried, rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures, ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeded from the Father and the Son, with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy and apostolic church. We acknowledge the forgiveness of sins. We look forward to the resurrection of the dead, life of the world to come. Amen. Amen and amen. You may be seated. As Sister Jack comes forward to do the prayer for the sick and shut-in, you will call out each name of a family member, church member, friend, relative, or anyone who is sick. And the response will be, Lord, in your mercy, we pray. After which Sister Jack will pray and we will sing the hymn, Breathe on Me, Breath of God. The names? Lord, Lord, in your mercy we pray. 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 Brother George Samuels.
Lord, in your mercy.
Dolores Alexander. Barbara Pottinger.
Lord, in your mercy.
Elma Small.
Lord, in your mercy.
Norma Hartley.
Lord, in your mercy.
Albert Newville. Doreen Hamilton Clark, Lennox Simon, Lord, in your mercy we pray. And we give God thanks for Olga Jones, who is now at home, out of the rehab, and she's at home. So let us celebrate her return to home. Sister Jack.
Thank you. breathe on us, O breath of God, and fill us this morning with life anew. This morning, approach my soul to mercy seat, where Jesus answers prayer. We humbly fall beneath your feet, for Lord, none can perish there. Today thy promise is our only plea, and with thee we venture nigh. Thou callest burdened souls to rest, and such, O Lord, am I. My God and my Redeemer, this morning the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, come and magnify yourself, Lord, in this your holy temple. This morning, Spirit of the living God, come and magnify yourself, O God, in your holy temple. Father, go from pew to pew. Anoint each and every one that is sitting here this morning. For Lord, as we come to give you thanks. We come to give you praise. Lord, we thank you for spared life and for tender mercies. We thank you, O God, because you did not have to do it, but you have done it. You have spared our lives to see another glorious day. So we say thank you. Thank you, O God, because you are our Alpha and you are our Omega. You are our beginning, Lord, and you are our end. This morning, Heavenly Father, greater is you that is in us than he that is in this world. So magnify yourself this morning, Father. Come, Lord Jesus, come and magnify yourself in this place. Father, we bring your people, the sick and the shut in. Those names, O God, that have been lifted up before your throne of grace. Those that were spoken in hearts. You know the secret hearts, Lord, that did not open their mouths, but you know their needs, you know their wants. You know the sick and the afflicted this morning that needs a special, special touch from you. So God, send Dr. Holy Ghost to each and every sick and afflicted person. Send Dr. Holy Ghost this morning to the homes, to the rehabs, to the nursing homes. Lord, even right here now, we need a special healing anointing. So release upon your sick and afflicted, Lord, your healing virtue, your miracle virtue. Release your healing anointing, your miracle anointing this morning. For your word, O God, in Isaiah 53 and verse 5 said, you were wounded for our transgressions. You were bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon you, and by your stripes this morning, we decree, we declare, and we are commanding healing in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, send your healing upon your people. If it's any time we need you, Lord, we need you now. Meet each and every one that is here and online, Lord. Those that are looking on. Father, meet us at the point of our needs. This morning, Heavenly Father, supply wants and needs this morning. Open up new doors of opportunities, especially, Lord, for our young people. Father, at this time and hour, even those that are seeking advancement on their jobs, those that are seeking employment, we ask, O God, that you'll go before them. Let favor go and speak for them. As you send Aaron to speak for Moses, send your Holy Spirit. Let favor, Lord, go before them and speak for them. Let favor be all around them. Heavenly Father, shine forth your glory upon them this morning. Our children and young people need you. Lord, if it's any time they need you, Lord, they need you now. So we ask, oh God, that you'll continue to saturate them with your blood. Soak them in your blood. Wash them, Lord, because your blood will never, ever lose its power. Where they are weak, Father, make them strong. And where they are strong, make them even stronger in the mighty name of Jesus. You say that our children should be the head and not the tail. They shall be above only and not beneath. They shall be lenders and not borrowers. You would go before them and you will come back with them. You would lead them, guide them, guard them, and direct them. So, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, order their steps in your word. Order their steps in your word. Lord, each and every youth, young people in this church, online, Lord, you know them by name, you know them by nature. Order their steps in your word, for the steps of a good man is ordered by you. And your word, Lord, is a lamp unto their feet and a light unto their pathway. Go before them, dear God. Make every crooked part in their way straight, and every rough place, Father, make it smooth in the mighty name of Jesus. Have thine own way in their lives, Lord. Have thine own way. You are the potter, and they are the clay. So make them and mold them after thy way this morning. Lord, for not forgetting those of us that are older at this time and hour, and need you, oh God, we need you. We need you every hour, Lord, we need you. So bless us now, our Savior. Heavenly Father, this morning, we give you thanks for our strength this morning. Thank you, Lord, for our health and our strength. Thank you for clothing us in a robe of righteousness. Lord, because of that, we can stand boldly before your throne of grace and give you thanks, give you praise. Lord, we can go forth and tell of your wonderful works, what you have done for us, how you have taken our sicknesses, our sins, our iniquities, our affliction, our infirmities, our infections, how you took them upon yourself. And Lord, you grant unto us life everlasting. Father, we thank you. We praise you. We magnify your name. Thank you this morning, Father. Thank you, mighty God. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen.
Thank you, Sister Jack, for interceding, not only on behalf of the sick and shut-in, but on behalf of all of us here present. Thank you, Sister Jack. As the praise team come forward, we invite you to stand if you can and join in giving praise and worship to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Praise the Lord, church. Praise the Lord, church. I want to invite everyone to just stand up so that we can just praise our God this morning. I know sometimes, you know, with the Resurrection Sunday, we're all excited to be here. And then the next Sunday, you know, we come in and our spirit may not be as happy and as joyful. But I just want to invite you, because Psalm 47 says, God has risen with a shout of joy. The Lord has risen as a trumpet sounded. So sing praises to God. Sing praises unto God. Amen?
Amen.
So we're going to begin as we declare that Jesus is Lord. We're going to begin with
happy day.
He is Lord. That's going to be our first one. He is Lord. And then, oh, it is Jesus. Amen.
He is Lord.
He is Lord.
is Jesus in my soul. In my soul.
In my soul.
And why? Because you have what?
For I have touched.
You have touched a hem.
The hem of his heart.
And his blood has made you whole. Jesus.
Oh, it is Jesus.
If you believe it, come on, shout it.
Yes, it is Jesus.
Yes, it is Jesus. About what happened this week.
Yes, it is.
It was only Jesus that brought us through. Tomorrow, by the grace of God, an eclipse is going to happen, and we're going to be praying for each other. So today you're giving him thanks because it is only Jesus. Brother Gavin, without the music, just think about it. It is only Jesus. Sorry, Sister Bridget. It's only Jesus. So just sing it one more time without the assistance of Brother Gavin. Just think about it. Everything that has happened and has happened this week, it is only Jesus
yes.
that has brought us here
Hallelujah.
By the grace of God.
Yes.
The table has already been set for you and for
Amen.
Me. So I want you to sing it. Let it be a testimony. It is only Jesus. He has risen. He has paid the ultimate
Hallelujah.
Sacrifice. It is only Jesus. I just want you to sing it. Just tell yourself, close your eyes, and just tell him, Father, it is only you. The message has already been prepared. And I come, Father God, because it says that yea, do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. So I know, Father God, it is only you. So just you, just sing it.
Oh, it is Jesus. Yes, it is Jesus. It is Jesus in my soul.
The hem of his garment.
up one more time. Sister Grace, you have the tambourine? Thank you. Start me off with the tambourine. It's happy days, if you remember. Oh, happy days, oh, happy. Come on, we gotta pick it up. It's a, come on, let's clap our hands, tambourine, let's go, Brother Gavin. We are off this morning. Come on, oh, happy days. It's a happy day, come on. We know how to do it. Come on. Sister Grace, give me the tambourine. Come on.
When Jesus washed,
when he washed my sins away. Oh, happy day. Oh, happy day. When Jesus washed,
when he washed my sins away.
Emmanuel Boyce will read the scriptures from the New Testament. Acts chapter 4, reading verses 32 to 35.
Good morning, church. The reading is taken from Acts chapter 4, verse 32 to 35. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. With great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked, for as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them, and brought the prices of the things that were sold, and laid them down at the apostles' feet. And distribution was made unto every man according as he had, as he need. This is the word.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as we recite the Psalter found on page number 850 in the Methodist hymnal. Behold How good and pleasant it is when we live together in unity.
It is like the precious oil upon the head, running down upon the beard, upon the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes.
It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion.
For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore.
As you take your seats, please extend the hand of peace to each other. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. And now Sister Sandra Skyers will come to bring the children's message. Will all the children come forward?
Good morning, good morning. I hear the congregation answer, but none of you did. All right. So, has any one of you ever been in a bad situation, seen anyone in a bad situation and helped them out? Yes, yes. All right, that's good. So, I'm going to tell you a story about a little boy and a little girl who were in third grade. Anybody here in third grade? No? I'm a little behind. I don't even know what age it is for third grade, but anyway, so there was this 9-year-old boy sitting at his desk, and all of a sudden there was this puddle between his feet, and the front of his pants are wet. His heart is beating so fast he thinks it's gonna stop because he couldn't possibly imagine how this could have happened. It's never happened before, and he knows that when the boys find out, he will never hear the end of it. And when the girls find out, Lord have mercy, they will never speak to him again as long as he lives. So the boy believed his heart is going to stop. So he puts his head down and he prays this prayer. Dear God, this is an emergency. I need help now because 5 minutes from now, I'm dead meat. So he looks up from his prayer, and here comes a teacher with a look in her eyes that says, yeah, I know what happened. As the teacher's walking towards him, a classmate named Susie is carrying a goldfish bowl that is filled with water. So Susie trips in front of the teacher and dumps the bowl of water in the boy's lap. The boy immediately took advantage of the situation and pretended to be angry. But all the while, he's saying to himself, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord. Now, all of a sudden, instead of him being laughed at, the boy is being offered sympathy from his classmates. The teacher rushes him downstairs and gives him a pair of gym shorts to put on while his pants dries out. All the other children on their hands and knees cleaning up the water that was spilled from the fishbowl and around his desk. Now, of course, the boy was feeling so much better. He's not going to be embarrassed after all. But as life would have it, Instead of him being laughed at, someone else was getting the ridicule. Guess who? Yes, Susie. She even tried to help, but they tell her to get out. You've done enough, you klutz. They even called her clumsy and stupid. Finally, at the end of the day, as they were waiting for the bus, the boy walks over to Susie and whispers, "You did that on purpose, didn't you?" Susie whispers back, "Yes, I did. I wet my pants one time, too." So, if you were like Susie and you saw that situation, what would you have done?
Tell me, what would you have done?
The same thing.
The same thing?
What's the same thing?
Dump the water on his pants.
All right. What about you, Ezra?
I probably would have excused myself from the classroom.
Okay. Anybody else? No? Jazzy? No? Okay. No? Okay. That's all right.
So, you could give him a sweater, something to cover him up, you know, your shirt, your hoodie. You know, you could tell the teacher. Yes, and we should always be helpful to each other. There's all of these things are helpful. And there are always opportunities where we can support one another, where we can help one another. So the next time you see someone needing help, instead of laughing at that person or putting that person down or even recording it on your phones, because I know a lot of you guys, that's all you do, these just record it on your phones, as is common nowadays. How about figuring out ways to help that person? I'm sure you'd want to help someone to help you if you were in that situation, right? Right. All right. So that's my story for today, so let us pray. Father, you said to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices you are pleased, and that whatever we do for the least of these, we are doing it for you. So help us, Father, to see the opportunities that are around us to do good. Teach us, Father God, and not just these children, but every one of us, Lord God, to be patient, to be kind, and to be loving towards each other every day. In the name of Jesus we pray, and all God's children say,
amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Skyers, for that message. Okay. Let us take a moment to look at our church at work on this second Sunday of Easter. Is there anyone celebrating a birthday today or this week? If so, would you stand so that we can recognize your birthday? Any birthdays this week? And may you continue to be blessed with every good in life. Any anniversaries this month? If so, would you stand? Let's all stand and celebrate. Women in Faith will be having their Women's Day service at 10 a.m. the team, dining at the King's table. There will be a guest speaker, and they have asked for you to wear white or off-white for this service. There is a flyer in the narthex. You can pick up one on your way out. But next Sunday, the women will be observing Women's Day. And then the following Sunday, April 21st, will be the annual Men's Day service at 4 p.m. in the afternoon. Their team, men of courage and humility, leading the way. You can see any member. Is this a paid program? Oh. The preacher will be Reverend Springer. And again, there is a flyer in the narthex. You can pick up one on your way out and spread the word that the men will be having their service, their day, on April 21st at 4 p.m. And then on April 28th, Bring Your Faith to Life. This is a collaboration between the Methodist churches in Brooklyn, and there will be gospel singing, dancing, music, everything that you can think of. So come out on April 28th at 4 p.m. and bring your faith to life. Committee meetings. Next Saturday, April 13th, the anniversary committee will meet at 11 a.m., followed by the church council at 1 p.m. And then next month, May 5th, the usher board will be having a bake sale after service. Flyers will be available in the narthex with more details. As you all know, we are celebrating our 178 years in ministry. There will be a special service on Sunday, September 15th at 4 p.m. So be prepared. You can start putting together your donations for 178 years. You do not have to do it all at one time. You can do it in proportions. And let's start getting ready for the anniversary celebration. And on that point, Sister Lola Clark has an announcement as well.
Good morning, church. This year, our church, St. Paul's, is celebrating 178 years of ministry in this community. God has seen us through a lot since our last journal publication 9 years ago. Some have lost loved ones, others have relocated, and even with the immediate and physical losses of our church community, God has still been faithful in allowing our virtual membership to grow while bringing new brothers and sisters into our physical church family as well. So, with our membership growing and changing all the while, centering our mission of connecting under the United Methodist Church tenets, we have decided to bring back one of our most anticipated fundraisers, the Anniversary Journal. On behalf of the Anniversary Committee and Journal Subcommittee, I am asking you, brothers and sisters, to join us by participating in this fundraising endeavor. There are two ways that you can participate. The first one is by completing at least one booster page. Each booster page holds 20 names, and each booster names cost $20. Imagine how awesome it would be if each person here today committed to completing one booster page asking friends and family to donate. Therefore, I will be in the narthex as well as the other members of the committee after service with blank booster page solicitation form for those here who would like to serve in this way. Second, we ask you all to go into your various neighborhoods and solicit family businesses, local entrepreneurs, family and friends to consider buying a quarter page, half page, or a full page, or even one of our coveted cover placements. Prices for these various page allotments are available to you to review and take to your neighborhood and family connection with services as well as in the narthex. These information are in the narthex. As a reminder, this year's anniversary theme is Building Bridges, Bridges Generation. As we focus on intergenerational connection within the church and foster dialogue between different age groups, we see our journal as an opportunity to highlight and encompass all the church community, from our little ones to our seasonal folk and everyone in between. Each and every one of us can be represented in this journal in some way, shape, or form. Whether it be a booster page, a quarter page, half page, or a cover opportunity, please consider contributing to this fundraising endeavor and going out into our community, building bridges and making solicitation in businesses, family members, and friends who can contribute as well and understand the value of supporting a church family that supports the entire community. As we bring back this beloved tradition, I am reminded of our dear late brother, Brother Samuel Palmer, who was one of the first to introduce the creation of the journal to St. Paul's as an intentional community-building opportunity. When we solicit a booster or a portion of the journal, invite the person to church and to our anniversary events. Watch and see how God will work through us for the goodness of his kingdom by way of this journal. Thank you for your time, and may we have a blessed 178th anniversary this year.
Thank you, Sister Lola, and I know this will be repeated throughout the coming months, and I hope it inspires you to contribute to this effort. Other events this year, the youth will be sponsoring a pre-Mother's Day brunch on Saturday, May 11th at 11 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. Tickets are $30 each, and we invite you to bring your mother, your grandmother, your mother-in-law, everybody to this pre-Mother's Day brunch, May 11th at 11 a.m. Our weekly activities continue as usual. The youth choir will meet on Tuesdays at 6 p.m., the chancel choir at 7 p.m., and the men's ensemble at 8:30 p.m. You're also invited to join any one of the choirs as you feel urged to do so. Our youth group ministry meets on Fridays at 6 p.m., and our liturgical dance rehearsals are on Saturdays. The women will meet at 2 p.m., the youth will meet at 3 p.m. Anyone interested in dancing or in joining this ministry, please see Sister Cheryl Ferdinand. So, those are all the announcements for this week. And we hope that we get your attention and your participation. Where else are we now? At this time, the stewards will come forward for the offering. The affirmation of tithing. We are a tithing church because the Word of God teaches tithing. Our experience gives witness to tithing. Our obedience to God requires tithing.
So let us bring our tithes and offerings to the Lord, as the Lord has prospered us, for a tenth shall be holy unto him.
Most precious gift of all, we return to you this day our thanks, represented in these gifts and in the lives of all these dear people. Bless these gifts and all these people that they may be lights of your love in our dark world. Amen. Be seated as Sister Sheree comes forth to bless us with a liturgical selection. Thank you, Sheree, for reminding us that. Thank you, Sheree, for reminding us that Jesus is the author and finisher of all life. When Jesus say yes, nobody can say no. Amen. The gospel lesson will be read by Brother Joshua Acevedo, reading from John chapter 20, verses 19 to 31.
Good morning, church. Good morning. The gospel lesson is taken from John 20, verses 19 to 31. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, Peace be unto you. And when he had so said, he shewed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then said Jesus to them again, Peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, even so I send you. And when he had said this, he breathed unto them and saith unto them, Receive ye Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins he remit, they are remitted unto them. And those whosoever sins he retain, they are retained. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, We have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, Except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put the finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. And after 8 days, his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, Peace be unto you. Then he said unto Thomas, Reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands. And reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered and said unto him, My Lord and my God. Jesus saith unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written, that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and believing that ye might have life through his name. The word of God to the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And before you sit, the hymn of preparation. Oh, the chancel choir will then render a sedition.
Amen, amen, amen. Hosanna, 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 Lord save us. So again today we are in the gospel according to John as he continues the resurrection story. Son of God, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O God, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. So on last Sunday, we shared with Mary getting up early in the morning and going to the tomb to see her Savior, going to the tomb with spices to anoint the body of her Savior. And then when she got there, she just imagined she traveling in the early morning, in the dark, heading to a cemetery where most of us wouldn't do. She may have been thinking about the stone, who gonna roll the stone away? She may be thinking about many things as she traveled to get to the tomb. But surprisingly to her, when she got there, the stone was already rolled away. And the entrance to enter in was open. And then they went in and they found some stuff that Jesus wasn't there anymore. And we talk about that when the disciples came and went in, the body was gone, but the head wrap was still there, which Jesus left a message for them. And then the scripture reminds us this morning that then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and said unto them, peace be unto you. This was the same day, the same evening after Mary had her encounter with Jesus. The same day after the resurrection. The men, the disciples were in this place, in this room, with the door shut tight. The window, maybe the one window that they have was shut tight too. Could you imagine the fear? Everything was locked down. Everything was tightly shut. And Jesus stood in the midst of them. Just like that. And they tried to figure out what's going on. Who is this? It brings us back to the story of Daniel in the lion's den. And he appears. Of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fire, and he appears. And so now they were in this place, afraid of what the Jews would do to them if they go outside these doors. So they make sure everything was barred up. But Jesus' resurrected body did not need to come into no door because he was the door. He could appear, disappear, pass through materials and defy the law of gravity in his resurrection body. You see, the authorities that executed their leader, they reasonably expected that Jesus' fate could be their own. Jesus said to them, peace be unto you. He greeted them.
and his greetings, peace be unto you, compliments his word on the cross when he said, it is finished. His work on the cross accomplished peace between God and his people. Jesus is now in his glorified body, so it's not necessary for him to open the door. So this appearance of Jesus is the same evening that he had shown himself to Mary at the sepulchre that morning. Yes, it is still Sunday. These disciples had probably assembled to sort out what Mary had told them. They were still trying to figure it out. They were afraid to meet publicly for fear that they would be killed. So here we see Jesus, the King of Peace. His greeting is no surprise to them. And when he had said so, he showed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. The hands, the evidence. He proved to them that he who appeared to them is the one who was crucified. His appearance was different, yet the scars were still in his hands and side. The spirit body has a great deal to do with the physical body. But his change also, these disciples had been confused and perhaps some did not believe when Mary told them that she had seen Jesus. So now they know for themselves that yes, he is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Then Jesus said to them again, peace be unto you. As my Father had sent me, even so I send you. There's a peace that comes when we receive the truth of Jesus Christ into our lives. We have no fear of death because we know there is a resurrection. So now Jesus gives them a job to do. They are to carry the good news of the gospel to the entire world. Just as the Father sent Jesus on a mission to save the world, now Jesus sends his followers to save the world. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. So here the disciples are anointed by the Holy Spirit. Prior to the book of Acts. So this corresponds to the Holy Spirit's special ministries in the Old Testament. And such ministries were for special tasks. Soon the Holy Spirit would come and permanently abide with them and in them. Since the disciples did not actually receive the Holy Spirit until the day of Pentecost, some 40 days in the future, this statement must be understood as a pledge on Christ's part that the Holy Spirit would be coming. This Holy Spirit would breathe into these disciples eternal life. This would empower them to carry out the work that Jesus had begun. The very next verse tells you something of the power he has breathed into them. Jesus gave the spirit of everlasting life along with the powerful anointing. This divine life which Jesus gave the disciples would empower them to do things impossible to do in the flesh. So when he called you to ministry, he called these disciples, he trained them for 3.5 years they were in training. And now that he has to leave them and they have to go out into the world, they can't do the ministry on their own. So they need the anointing. It's the anointing that's empowered them to do the work. So don't try to go out there and try to do
ministry or do God's work on your own. If God didn't appoint you or anoint you to do it, leave it alone. It will kill you. For we see there are folks who are in ministry, and we see a lot of confusion because there's a man-made stuff. They create their own ministry, and they do it for years. Some folks have been doing it for years, and get it. When all of a sudden today we see headlines, and you say to yourself, these folks, we've been watching them for years. They've been preaching and teaching. Yes, the scripture said they have a godly connotation. They know of God, but the truth of God is not in them. And so we sit at home. We don't want to go out to worship. And we take in all of this. We send our money to them so they could send us a piece of rag, a piece of kerchief, a bottle of water that they say they get it from the Holy Land and all of that stuff. And we fill our place with it. But our heart is still empty. We are empty. And then your local church in the community, you wouldn't give to them. Because they don't have a piece of rag or a kerchief to give you. They don't have a bottle of holy water to you because the pastor is too poor to travel overseas to get water to bring back to you. So they can just go in the kitchen and turn your tap on, get your water, pray over it, and do what you got to do with it. And when he had said this, he breathed unto them. Jesus gave the spirit of everlasting life along with the powerful anointing. This divine life which Jesus gave these disciples will empower them, as we said, to do things that are impossible. He said, whosoever sins they are remitted unto them, and whosoever sins he retain, they are retained. This is a divine prerogative that God has given to us. The anointing of the Holy Spirit makes this possible. This is a very hard scripture, except for the fact that these disciples are extensions of Jesus' ministry. We are extensions of Jesus' ministry. Just as Jesus had said on another occasion that where two or three agree as touching anything on this earth, it shall be done of my Father in heaven. This doesn't mean that it gives us authority as Christians to forgive sins. We can't forgive sins. We have to guide and direct folks to Christ. He's the one who forgives sins. Jesus was saying that the believer can boldly declare the certainty of a sinner's forgiveness by the Father because of the work of his Son, that sinners had repented and believed the gospel. We bring them the word of God. If they believe it and accept Christ, then you have just brought someone home to glory. The believer with certainty can also tell those who do not respond to the message of God's forgiveness through faith in Christ that their sins, as a result, are not forgiven. We also read in John 14 that believers can do the same miracles Jesus did when he was on earth, if they are done in the name of Jesus. Not in your name, not in the pastor's name, in the name of Jesus. So when we pray, and when we ask God in the name of Jesus, whatever we ask, whatever we're requesting, it must be in the name of Jesus. This is an empowering to know and to use the name of Jesus. That's the authority that he has given unto us. Because we say these disciples are an extension of Jesus' ministry. They must do these things in his name. In the only difference is the power comes through Jesus. So it continues and it tells us that Thomas, one of the 12 called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. He said unto them, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and his trust in my hands into his side, I will not believe. So at least one of them were brave enough to be out. That's Thomas. Why is it important for Thomas and Christians to see the nail prints in Jesus' hand? Why was it important for him? Because the nail prints in Jesus' hands provide the authority of the believers. There is nothing more precious to the Christian than thinking about the nail-scarred hands of Jesus. It is known that as Jesus appeared to his disciples, the scars were the nail-pierced steel remains. And the wound on his side are scars that will remain upon him throughout eternity because we can never forget what he did for us. So the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it. A week later, his disciples were in the house again and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came in and stood among them and said, peace be unto you. Then said to Thomas, put your finger here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. But why on his hands? What does that mean? Is there any significance for us as believers? The nails that pierce his hands were an instrument that opened up one of seven streams of blood that have great benefit for believers. One day, you and I will see the nail prints in Jesus' hands. Understanding that the wounds on his hands provide a great benefit for us. It gives us authority as believers in Christ. Hands are amazing creations. Hands speak of authority. Even evolutionists unintentionally give credit to the Creator because of the hand. The evolutionists say that because of the way the thumb and four fingers work together is why man was able to work and climb to the top of the food chain. The hand is not a stroke of luck, of progress, but rather creation of God. It is God who gave man authority over the earth to subdue it, and man has given authority through our hands. When we think of the power and authority expressed by hands written about in biblical context, Moses in his hand held up the rod, which is a symbol of authority, and the waters parted. It was in David's hand he held the sling, where he applied his authority, and the giant Goliath fell to the ground. There is nothing more precious about a hand that is soft and kind like a mother's hand, because her hand on a fevered brow has the authority to soothe away the pain and the hurt. She reigns and uses her authority by giving love. The president of a country, as they're about to be sworn into office, lay hands upon the Bible. That gives them the authority The surgeon's hand wield a healing scalpel, and with authority, those hands operate and heal. The machine operator knows the power he has in his hands. One wrong move and many could die. Like the ship that ran into the bridge the other day. The captain have all power in his hands. One wrong move, and you see what happened? One wrong move. When you sit down at a computer and by using your hands, you are connecting with the world through the World Wide Web. It's interesting that we are commanded in Scripture as we worship to lift up our hands to Him, the supreme authority. It is as though the raising of our hands pays homage to the King, the supreme authority of the universe. His hands are symbols of authority. Christ is the ultimate authority in the church. It is not the pastor. It's Jesus. It is Christ. He is the head of the church. No wonder we see him in Revelation holding the seven stars in his hand and walking among the candlesticks. Talk about the stars. He's talking about the church. He's talking about the leaders. He's holding them up. How amazing are the hands of Jesus. His hands multiply the loaves and the fishes and feed thousands of people. His hands heal sick. His hands gave sight to the blind. His hands comforted the lonely and the hurting. His hands cleansed the leper. His hands drive out demons over out of demon-possessed people. His hands calm the storm. Peace, be still. His hands shelter us from danger. Those hands were the hands that were stretched out on the cross at Calvary for you and for me. They put that large spike nail and they pinned him to the cross. Blood flowed freely through his hands. We need to understand that the spikes and those nails did not hold Jesus to the cross. It was his love for us that kept him on the cross through his hands. The reason was that he was providing for us the authority of the believers through his hands. Because his hands were pierced, his authority has flown down across thousands of years through an unknown number of hands all around the world, doing ministry among the poor, doing ministry among the marginalized, doing ministry among the least of these. So Thomas warned facts. That's the fact about Jesus and his hands. Yes, it also reminds us much of many people today. They want facts before they will believe in Jesus. Facts and faith are not the same. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. So if you don't believe, then you're like doubting Thomas. The Bible and the Word of God must be taken by faith. What you believe. The scripture reminds us that faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. So we are hoping that a day Jesus had promised us that he has gone to prepare a place for us. And we are living in hope that one day he's coming back for us. Have you ever been to heaven? Have anyone ever showed you a picture of heaven? Our loved ones passed away and we buried them and they're gone. Have they ever come back to tell you about heaven? Like when your loved one, they travel overseas and when they come back, they have a lot of stories to tell us. Has they ever come back to tell us about this heaven, this place that we are hoping and preparing to go? No. But we still believe that Jesus is preparing this place for us because he told us so. He told us so in his word. And so we are preparing ourselves and getting ready. And while we are preparing and getting ready, we are using our hands to do good works. We are using our hands to feed the hungry. We are using our hands to comfort those who are sick. Because that's what he asks us to do. And then we pray. We have praying hands. Because Jesus said to Thomas, when Thomas started talking and started accepting who Jesus was. And Jesus is saying, because you see, you believe. That's not faith. That's not faith. But he said, blessed are those who have believed and yet not seen. God does not want us to believe with our mind. God wants us to believe with our heart because we love him. Faith, Hebrews 11:1 reminds us, faith, the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. This is the faith God respects. It takes no faith of all to believe in something you can see with your own eyes. There are a large number of people listed in God's book who believe without seeing. God loves and blesses them the most. Do you believe? And if you do, what do you believe? Do you believe Jesus is the Messiah? Do you believe he's the Christ, the anointed one? You believe he's the Son of God? Do you believe he was born of a virgin? Do you believe that we receive everlasting life when we truly believe in our heart these things? For Romans 10:9-10 say to us this way. This is all of it. If you shall confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and shall believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart man believe unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made. That's the sinner's prayer in total. Amen. 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 Amen and amen. Ain't God wonderful? We serve a risen Savior who's in the world today. I know that he's able, whatever the world may say. I see his hands of mercy. I hear his voice. Can you hear his voice calling you and talking with you? He wants to have a conversation with you. And by the time I need him, he's always there, for he lives. He lives. He lives within my heart. Does he live within your heart today? Is he walking with you, or are you walking with him? Are you talking with him? Do you believe the word of God that he lives? And there's an empty tomb to prove that my Savior and your Savior lives. God sent his son, they call him Jesus.
forgive, he live and die to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my sin.
Stable all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another.
We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard of the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Christ, Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us.
Let us offer.
The Lord be with you. Let us
lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth, and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit.
On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for the many, forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Pour out your Holy Spirit unto us, gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ. redeemed by his blood.
By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet.
Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
So at this time, you're invited to come to the altar rail for communion. There's no little cup today. So you got to get up and walk up to the altar as a sacrifice of joy. Amen.
Thank you.
6:20.6:25.
Come, let us eat, though not the feast is spread. Come. Jesus' bread. Our Lord's body let us take together. Our Lord's body let us take together. Come, let us drink, for now the wine is poured. Come, let us drink, for now the wine is poured. Jesus' blood poured out, let's drink together. Jesus' blood poured out, let's drink together. In his presence now we meet and rest. In his presence now we meet and rest. In the presence of our Lord we gather. In the presence of our Lord we gather. To spread abroad God's mighty word. Rise then to spread abroad God's mighty word. Jesus risen will bring in the kingdom. Jesus risen will bring in the
fill my cup, Lord. That's right.
Those of us who are called to sing to the glory of God. Come to rehearsal, come knowing that you're serving a mighty God. Come to rehearsal to sing before God, knowing that you are the one who's in charge. He's the one who gives you the voice. When you come to play with the passion that God has given and the gift.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
Say to us as often as you partake.
Yes. Hallelujah.
So God's remembrance of you reminds us.
Yes.
We surrender ourselves to God in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated.
That sounds like.
Okay. Thank you, Pastor, for that message today and for inviting us to have a feast with God. Amen. Amen. Just a few reminders. Next Saturday, the anniversary committee will meet at 11 a.m. followed by the church council meeting at 1 p.m. All committee members are asked to submit their reports, preferably before the meeting, or bring your committee reports to the meeting. I repeat this, committee members of the church council, please submit in advance your reports or bring them to the meeting itself at 1 p.m. next Saturday. Also, next Sunday is the Women's Day service at 10 a.m. You are reminded to wear white or off-white if possible. There will be a special guest speaker next Sunday. So come out, support the women, and fill this church with your presence. And on a sad note, I regret to announce the passing of Pastor Cundy's son-in-law, Mr. Marvin Mosley. The funeral service will be held on Thursday, April 11th in Queens. Pastor, do you know which church this is?
I have to get that information to the congregation, but it's going to be in Queens, but they're going to be doing the repass.
Yeah. So the funeral will be Thursday, April 11th. Information will be provided, and the repast will be here at St. Paul's at 7 p.m. Also, Sister Iseline James, who usually sits across there, her son has passed. Her grandson, Irving James, has passed, and his funeral service will be on Friday here at St. Paul's?
Saturday.
Okay, the funeral will be Saturday morning on April 13th. At what time?
9 o'clock. We're still having some sketchy reports, so we need to really get everything from the family. But we know it's confirmed. It's going to be Saturday morning. They're going to go to Pine Lawn, and they're going to be coming back here for repast also.
Okay, so we urge you to support the family, the families, Pastor Cundy's family, as well as Sister Iseline James's family.
And I have another quick announcement. I'd sent out the district email to all the speakers. Who I have the email. Brother Peter, need to see me at my office. I'm going to register you. Those who are not able to register themselves, just see with me. Just meet me at the office. And if you don't come on time, because orientation is this coming weekend, you don't meet on time, you're going to pay double. So I'll send the email out. If you get the email, just scroll down to that area if you're up for certification or whatever. Because if you're serving, you need to get this training in. You need to get them done. Amen? So, and if we have any of the young people who are interested, see me. I'll register you. You could pay me when you get a job. But see me and I'll register. It's not that you're going to have to do it because you're going to be preaching. No.
you learn a lot from these courses that you get, how to be a strong leader in your congregation. Amen? What do you think about it, Treasure? You thinking about it? So, Brother Pierce, you're going to see me? I sent it to your email. That's why I'm going to do it for you. That's why I'm going to do it for you. Your phone is axed, so you got to get a new phone. Okay, that's my announcement for now.
Okay.
I just want...
At the end of...
Oh, the meeting? Chapel. Because they will be setting up downstairs, not only for the funeral, for the woman program the next day. So you want to cancel? Okay. So we are going to be postponing church council meeting until further date. The following week? What's on the following week?
The anniversary committee will also meet, or that is postponed.
Anniversary committee meet in the week. Find a day in the week to meet. Yep, before Saturday. Yep. 28th? It's clear? The following week? Okay, good. Church council will be the following Saturday at 1 p.m. Got you.
And the anniversary committee will meet?
Meet sometime in the week.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. As we prepare to leave this place, but not from the presence of God, let us stand as we sing the closing hymn.
Fellowship hour. Fellowship hour.
Test, test. They just wanted to remind you that they have fellowship
downstairs.
Fellowship hour. It's first Sunday they have fellowship downstairs.